Sometimes I wonder, why am I different? And sometimes I think, am I really alone in all of this? Do you ever get embarrassed? You ever feel unloved? You ever feel unwanted? Do you ever feel rejected? Sometimes I wonder why I'm so different.
Good to see you guys. Thanks for being here today. We're in the second part of our series called Outcast, and we're going to be looking at a really cool, unique story here today. Last year, I love missions. I love going on missions trips. I love what God is doing around the world and have traveled to numerous countries and gone to a lot of different places. And this past year, I went to Africa and went to a couple of different countries in Africa, and I went to this one particular country. And we were traveling with a group of pastors. There were about eight or nine of us. And our team was being led by a guy by the name of Sam Johnson. And Sam is actually the president of, it's called Priority One International. And it's a ministry that we've actually partnered with. We've been working with them for a number of years now. And we help build Bible colleges and church planting and doing all kind of cool things working with them. And have built a great relationship. Sam's actually been to our church. But Sam was leading this trip. And, you know, him having been to this particular country numerous times, he said, okay, guys, now when we go in there, there's a visa that we have to pay for, and it's $25. And he told everybody there, $25. And we all said, okay. So we got through there, and we were going through kind of the customs and the immigration. We got to the part where we had to pay for the visa to go in country. And when I got up there, the guy that was working for the government there, working in that particular department, when it came time to collect the money, he said, okay, it's $50. I said, whoa, hold on, time out. I was told it was only $25, and here's, we had this paperwork, it was only $25. He said, okay, $25. So I paid the $25 and went through, and we kind of laughed. A couple of the guys were on the other side, and we were already laughing about it. Well, a couple of the pastors that I was traveling with went through, and they went through there. The guy said to him, when it was time to collect, he said, $100. They said, okay, and they just paid the $100 and just never even thought about it, and they came through, and they actually said to Sam, I thought you said that the visa was only $25, and he said, it is, you just got ripped off. You just got scammed, and and I'm just thinking to myself, I'm so glad I listened. This is a great time that I was a great listener. It was only $25. I knew how much to pay. But let me just ask you this. Don't you hate being taken advantage of? Don't you hate when you feel like people are just trying to scam you or trying to pull one over on you? I hate that feeling. And if you've ever traveled outside of the U.S. or even inside the U.S., there are a lot of scam artists. There are a lot of people that really will try to take advantage of you. And I want to look at today this story of probably one of the biggest shysters in the New Testament. And out of all 12 disciples, this guy was the biggest shyster, morally corrupt, out of all of them, and his name was Matthew, the tax collector. And so I want to look at his story a little bit, because the story of Matthew is pretty phenomenal. It's a pretty incredible story, and we're going to actually go to the Gospel of Matthew, and this is his story. So as we're reading under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, about 40 years later, Matthew is now writing back, and he's telling this story of what happened when he met Jesus. And so it's in Matthew chapter 9, in verse 9, it says, as Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. Follow me, he told him, and Matthew got up and followed him. And while Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? On hearing this, Jesus said, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy and not sacrifice, for I've not come to call the righteous, but sinners." And so we see here the conversion of Matthew and kind of the transformation place of Matthew's life. And really what I'd like to do is take a second, because this story is a great story, and I want to look at Matthew the tax collector and kind of Jesus, the calling of Jesus, and then what happened to Matthew after Jesus called him, and Matthew the disciple. And so I want to go, first of all, and let's just look at his story. Matthew the tax collector, as I just mentioned, this guy was a shyster. Being a tax collector was no, you know, there was no prestige in this. Actually, it was the exact opposite. Because Matthew was a tax collector, Matthew would have been disowned and rejected by his own family. Matthew's name was also called Levi. I'm not sure if Jesus changed his name to Matthew or, you know, how that transformation took place or how that happened. But his name was Levi. And just that name, Levi, tells us a little bit about his heritage. Most likely, because of that name Levi, he would have come from the tribe of Levi, from, you know, would have had this heritage of priests in his home, because back in the Old Testament, there were 12 tribes in Israel, and one of those tribes was called the tribe of Levi, and the tribe of Levi were known for being the quote-unquote pastors, the priestly tribe. And so here Matthew comes from this lineage, he comes from this incredible heritage where, you know, great-grandfathers and grandfathers, they had all been involved in religious work. But somewhere along the line, Matthew decided to stray away from that. He decided to turn away from religiosity and turn away from religion and turn away from all of that and turn towards really becoming a first-class, 100% authentic sinner. And so as a result of that, tax collectors were completely despised. And so his family rejected him, and not only his family, but the people, the nation, the Jewish people, his own people. You know, I just told that story about being in a different country, and I thought, it's one thing to get scammed when you're a foreigner going into another country. I remember going into Cairo, Egypt several years ago also, and in Cairo, I just felt like everywhere I turned, I was, you know, somebody was trying to take advantage of me or scam me. I was putting my bag when I was leaving. And by then, I had learned the system. You know, I had learned just a no, you know. And I was taking my suitcase and putting it on the conveyor belt, the baggage belt, and literally it's right there. And I took my bag, and as I'm putting it there, this guy, it looked like he was kind of, you know, a worker or something. He came running over, and he had a badge that just had his name on it. And he came running over, and he grabbed my bag right out of my hands. He just grabbed it. We almost fought over it for a second. But he grabbed my bag and then just set it down on the belt. And then he said, "I don't think so," you know. It's one thing to kind of be scammed when you're an international going over into another country, but it's a completely different thing when you feel like it's your own people. It's a completely different thing when you feel like it's your own family and the people that you're close to. And that was Matthew. Matthew had no problem scamming the other people, and the Jews hated tax collectors. See, to be a tax collector, here, and you say, what was the big deal about tax collectors? Why were they so hated? Well, to be a tax collector, what you would do is you would actually go to the Roman emperor. It would be like purchasing a business or a franchise. And so they would go and they would purchase this franchise, this tax franchise for X amount of dollars, whatever that was. And so then they would already prepay, if you will, they would prepay the taxes to Rome. And then they would purchase this franchise, and then at various points throughout the city or the community, they would then set up booths and set up stations. So as people came and went, they would stop them and charge them based on the goods that they were buying or selling and charge taxes on that. And what tax collectors would do is they would inflate the amount of taxes so that they could line their own pockets. And you know, like me with the guy, you know, when I was in Cairo, I just said no. But you know, for the Jewish people, they couldn't just say no because the tax collectors, because they had bought this franchise, they had the support of Rome. So here's Matthew. Matthew would sit in his tax booth, and he could charge really most anything that he wanted to. And if anybody said no to him, then he had two big old Roman soldiers that were right behind him that would shake them down. And so he could pretty much do what he wanted. And so as a result, here's Matthew, not only hated, I mean, think about it. He was hated by his people. He was considered a traitor, but he was also hated by Rome. And so he really didn't have a place to fit in. And so you have this guy that's incredibly wealthy, but he's making all of his money after cheating and trying to, from cheating people and trying to take advantage of them. And so Matthew was hated. Tax collectors were hated. They were despised. They were pretty much professional extortionists, no moral integrity. And not only was he rejected by his people, but he was also rejected by religion. And this is where Matthew's story kind of takes an interesting twist. Because of Matthew being a Jewish man, growing up as a young boy, he would have heard the Torah. He would have known most of those scriptures. He would have known so much about the God of the Old Testament. And somewhere along the line, Matthew saw the God of the Old Testament, but he saw the religiosity of the Jewish people. And he saw the frailty, and he saw the hypocrisy. And somewhere, Matthew's heart rebelled against religion. He turned away from that. And tax collectors were so hated, they were so despised, that actually in the Talmud, it's actually the life application portion of the Jewish law. It actually says that you can mistreat, or it's okay to lie to tax collectors because they don't fit in. And so Matthew would have been rejected by religion. He would never have been allowed to go to the temple to pray. He wouldn't have been able to go there to offer sacrifice or to worship. He would have been excluded, if you will, from the church people. He would have been excluded from the Pharisees, from the religious crowd. He wouldn't have been able to be around them at all. In Luke chapter 18, Luke tells this story of Jesus, and Jesus is sharing this parable that says that there was a tax collector who stood far off. And he prayed and he said, "Lord, have mercy on me, I'm a sinner, far off." And then you have the Pharisee who stood at the temple and he raised his hands and he said, "Lord, I thank you that I'm not like tax collectors and I'm not like sinners." And Jesus told the story to contrast the heart of the Pharisee and the heart of the tax collector, and that those who will be humbled, those that are, will humble themselves will be exalted, but those who exalt themselves will be humbled. But what's interesting in this story is just that little phrase, "he stood far off." That he was rejected by the religious crowd. That the tax collector wasn't allowed to be anywhere around. And so here is Matthew, who's grown up really with this heritage of quote-unquote faith, this heritage of religiosity, but yet he rejected the hypocrisy of it. And he said, rather than be a hypocrite, listen to me, this is really important, rather than be a hypocrite and be a quote-unquote religious hypocrite with one foot in the world and one foot in religion, rather than do that, I would rather just be a tax collector and the best sinner that I can possibly be. That was Matthew. And so we see this incredible rejection in Matthew's life. But then we see kind of this transformation that begins to take place. Because in verse 9, look at this. In verse 9, it says, "As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth, and he said, 'Follow me.'" Jesus simply said those two words, "Follow me." Those two words, listen, those two words in Matthew's life at the right moment changed everything. And as incredible as Matthew's story is, the call of Jesus to me is even more incredible. Because let me tell you what this tells me about Jesus. Just this little verse that we have right here, where Jesus approaches Matthew at his tax collector's booth. Despite Jesus really, Jesus shouldn't have been anywhere around this guy, but yet Jesus met him right where he was. And do you realize that's one of the great things about the call of Jesus, is Jesus meets you where you are. Jesus meets you where you are. What religion does, religion says, if you'll clean up, if you'll straighten up, if you'll, you know, do the right things, if you'll sober up, if you'll do all the right things over here, and you'll get the standards right, then you can come to Jesus. And I'm just wondering if that's the reason why people reject the church today, is because the church hasn't been authentic in its own faith with Christ. It's because we try to make out these rules that if you'll just clean up, you can come to church if you clean up. You can come to church if you'll get your life together. You can only come to church if your marriage is right. You can only come to church if your kids are right. You can only come to church if this is right or this is right. And if you do all those things, or at least let us believe that those things are okay, even though they may not be, if you'll at least play the game, then you can go to church. Then you can meet Jesus. And it's no wonder with churches all across America that operate that way, that there's this mentality of people, they're not anti-God, they're anti-church. It's not that they don't want any part of God, but they don't want any part of the hypocrisy. And that's the amazing thing, is we've been teaching, I really believe, a false doctrine, because people don't need to clean up to come meet Jesus. Jesus meets people right where they are. I'm getting ready to get wound up in a minute. You know, my story is kind of an interesting story. If you've been around, you've heard me tell that at 16 years old, I felt the call of God. I was at a youth camp, and I felt the call of God to preach. And I just felt the nudge of God in my heart that I would go into full-time ministry. And I had grown up in a pretty strict religious environment. The church that I went to, it was pretty legalistic. But yet I had this call of God to preach. I wasn't anti-church at the time. I was very much pro-God. But then once I really began to see the things that I've been taught, and realizing that so many things that I understood to be true were just made up man concepts that had nothing to do with the Word of God, my heart kind of got cold. Even though I had this call of God on my life, I went through a number of years where I strayed away from the call of God. You know, I was called into full-time ministry at 16 years old, felt that man, just that desire, that passion on the inside that I'm going to serve Jesus with all of my heart, with all of my life. But what I sensed on the inside and what I sensed God wanted to do with my life didn't line up with where I was in church. The two were just disconnected, because I knew that this is what my heart was saying, but I'm never going to be able to meet all these guidelines. I'm never going to be the kind of pastor that's going to be able to live up to all the requirements and live up to all the standards and live up to all of those things. I am just not that good. And so I got discouraged when I saw all the things that I had to be, not realizing that Jesus met me where I was and that he meets us where we are. So I went through a few years of really rebelling. Even in that state, I graduated from high school, and even though I was in that anti-church state and didn't even want any part of church or even going to church, even though I was in that place, I still went to Bible college, which was unique. I didn't do very good in Bible college. As a matter of fact, I want to tell you, I had one of the craziest GPAs, a 0.02 GPA. I didn't even have a good F. I had a bad F. You know, it couldn't even be a high F. It was a terrible F. I mean, I failed to fail. I mean, it was just awful. And the best thing that happened to me in Bible college, I mean, here I am, this Bible college flunky as your pastor. Imagine that. The best thing that happened to me in Bible college was meeting my wife, Christy. That was the best thing that happened. Because when we started dating and hanging out, she was the goody-goody. I was the bad boy. I was the guy that was rebelling and doing all the crazy stuff and the rebellion in campus. And I mean, I had my little whole pocket of friends, and we did all the crazy stuff, and we got in trouble all the time. Praise God for Christy, because she ran with the good crowd. Matter of fact, some of her friends said, "You know, Christy, you shouldn't date that Ed guy. He doesn't even know Jesus. He's not even saved. I don't know why you were hanging out with him." Well, it's pretty obvious, isn't it? I mean, when you just see the looks right here, it's obvious why she... Anyway, and... Why are you laughing? Anyway. But Christy, man, I was so grateful, because I remember when we were dating, she was so helpful, because she would go to some of her friends who were in key leadership positions, and when I would get called in because of stupid things that I would do, she would go, she was like the Jesus for me. She would intercede on my behalf. Oh, don't kick him out. Just give him another chance. Just don't report him. Just give him one more chance. Needless to say, I mean, fortunately, I mean, she helped keep me from getting kicked out numerous times. But I still flunked out. I still flunked out of Bible college. And as a result of that, I was put on academic probation. And they said, "You can't come back here for quite a while." I remember just spinning my wheels. We ended up getting married. And I just felt lost. I don't know if you've ever been in that place in life. Maybe you're there now. I just felt lost. I felt like I had no direction. Like I said, I wasn't anti-God. I knew I had this call of God on my life, but I was just anti all the junk of church. And I just could not see how this call that God had placed on my life could fit in the context of the church. And I felt discouraged, and I spent a few years just spinning my wheels. I think in like a two-year period, I held like 20 different jobs. One of the jobs that I had was with a company called Phase 4. Sounds really impressive, doesn't it? It's not all that impressive. It was a vacuum cleaner. And I thought I was going to make all this money in sales selling vacuum cleaners, these computerized vacuum cleaners that do it all. And we would sell you this vacuum cleaner for $1,000. And when we sold it for $1,000, I would make $250 on it. So I'm thinking, man, can you just imagine if I sold 4 a week, I'm going to be rich. At least that was my thinking at the time. Well, this will be great. Just one a day or like one every 2 days. Chrissy, we're going to be golden. We're only paying $175 a month in rent. We're going to be in great shape. I'll never forget selling my first vacuum cleaner. I was ecstatic. It was just the beginning for me. I called in and said, I just want you guys to know I sold this first unit. I'm so excited. Go ahead and send me my check. I hung up the phone and I looked over across the table and I said, thank you, Mom and Dad. Thank you so much for purchasing the very first. And I never sold another one. Parents, you understand. I understand now as a parent. You want to help your kids out. My parents were trying to help me out. And later on they said, we should have just given you the $1,000. Got a broke down vacuum cleaner that doesn't work in the closet. That was the only one I ever sold. My dad worked for the airline industry. Hope I'm not boring you with my story. My dad worked for the airline industry he had been with them for 25 years for a company called Eastern Airlines, for those of you that have been around. And so he got me a job. He worked in upper management. He got me a job working in reservations. I was working there for a few months, and he picked me up one day for lunch. We were having lunch, and it was getting a little late, and I said, Dad, I've got to get back. I've got to get back on the clock. And he said, Ed, don't worry about it. He said, they're getting ready to come out with the press conference this afternoon. As of this afternoon, the company will be shut down. No sense even going back. And in that moment, I felt like my life crumbled. I'd been married several years, 3 years at that time. My son Bryce had just been born. He was 3 weeks old. I was broke, penniless, discouraged, no direction, anti-church, anti-religion. I've tried every job I know. And I didn't know what to do. I was so down. I was so discouraged. And it was so crazy that it was in that moment, although I was so discouraged and I was so disappointed with life, and I was even disappointed with the calling that I sensed God had placed on my life years earlier, that it was in that moment, in that messed up state of mind that I was in, that's where Jesus met me. That's where he met me. He met me in that brokenness. He met me in that hurt. He met me in that place where I felt like I had no sense of direction of even where to go or what to do. He met me there. And he didn't call me to a place of religiosity and saying, if you'll just get back over here on track, and you'll just get back doing the right things and get back over here to meeting the standards. He said to me, if you'll just follow me, I'll change stuff. See, Jesus met me where I was. And that's the good news for everybody here. It doesn't matter what state you're in. You don't have to clean up to meet Jesus. Did you hear what I said? You don't have to clean your life up to meet Jesus. Jesus met Matthew at the tax booth, collecting and extorting money out of people. That's where Jesus met him. Jesus meets us where we are. And here's the other thing. Jesus sees you for who you are. He sees your life. He sees you. And he sees stuff, and this is so cool. I said, man, I love God so much. I love Jesus so much because he saw something in my life that I didn't see in myself. And he sees something in your life that you don't see in yourself. He saw something in Matthew. Everybody saw a tax collector. What Jesus saw was the heart of a guy that would be one of his greatest disciples. Jesus sees us
in a different way. He sees us in a different light, unlike we see ourselves even. Even though we know who we are on the inside, Jesus sees past all the junk and he sees past all the garbage, and he sees us in a completely different way. Now think about it. We're hearing the story. Let's just turn it a little bit. Let me tell you what I think Jesus saw. Here's a guy, Matthew, who had pretty much rebelled against organized religion. He didn't want any a part of it, but all his peers, all his friends who were becoming Pharisees, and the crowd that even as he was growing up with, they had learned how to live one foot in the world and one foot in religion. And Matthew somewhere said, you know what? I'm not going to live like that. I'm not going to live as a hypocrite. I'm not going to live with just enough God in my life that I'm miserable in the world and just enough world in my life that I'm miserable in God. I'm not going to live that way. So Matthew said, I don't see any hope in all of this. All I see is rules, standards. I don't see any relationship here. So rather than try to live my life that way, I'm just going to become a tax collector and be the best sinner that I can be and just become wealthy and do whatever I want to do. I think Jesus saw that side of him that people would look at and say, what an incredible weakness. Jesus looked at him and saw, what incredible commitment. What an incredible commitment. Even though he made the wrong choice, what incredible commitment. Jesus sees us where we are. But here's the cool thing. He doesn't leave us as we are. He doesn't just leave us there. In that split second, Jesus came along, and in those two words says to Matthew, Matthew, follow me. Those two words changed everything in Matthew's life. That split second, as Matthew now stands up, I want you to see, we see Matthew the tax collector, and we see the call of Jesus now in his life to follow me. Matthew has a decision to make, and Matthew the disciple now, he turns just in that split moment. He stands up and he looks at his receipts. He looks at his calculator. He looks at his Mac computer that he's tracking everything on Excel. He looks at the people lined up that he's getting ready to make a whole lot of money on. And maybe he looks back over his shoulder and he sees his nice, fine house sitting on the hillside. He looks at all of that and he looks at Jesus, and in that split second, he makes this decision to go from Matthew the tax collector to Matthew the disciple. And at that moment, he decides to abandon everything and follow Jesus. An incredible life of commitment. And that for all of us, wherever your heart is today, it's a great lesson for all of us. Maybe you're in an anti-religion state. Maybe somebody invited you today, or you're here just checking things out, and you're just kind of seeing where God is or seeing where Jesus is and how he relates to your life. Maybe you've been around for the church for a long time. Here's the thing. Jesus doesn't leave us. He calls on us to bring us to that place where we make total commitment. Total commitment is what he requires. What he longs for. He doesn't want us living one foot in, one foot out. He says, I want you to follow me, period. I don't need you to clean up. All I need you to do is just get up and walk away. I don't need you to, you know, do all this stuff. And if it just, Matthew, get up, walk away and follow me. Matthew, split moment. I love this. Complete commitment. And then, you know, the second thing I love about Matthew, you know what Matthew does? Immediately, Matthew calls for and has a big banquet at his house. Luke actually tells us, Matthew says that it was a dinner that night that he hosted. Luke tells us it was a banquet. Matthew was being humble. Luke says, no, his place was big enough that he had a banquet. And the people that he invited to the banquet were tax collectors and sinners and prostitutes. Well, hold on a second. Why don't we invite the people that are a little bit better? Because Matthew didn't know anybody else. Matthew only knew other shysters. He only knew people that he had to, you know, watch them when they walked into his house, make sure they didn't steal from him. Those are the only people that he knew. He only knew prostitutes. He only knew people who were far away from God. He only knew sick people. He only knew people that were messed up in the head and sinners far from God, people that had rejected religiosity. That's the only people he knew, but those are the people that he shared with. He said, I want you all to come because I want you to meet this guy, Jesus, who in a moment changed my life. I'm telling you, that would have been a dinner that we all would have been uncomfortable at. But Jesus isn't afraid. Jesus isn't afraid to get involved with you and to get connected with the things that are in your heart. Jesus doesn't shy away from the junk that you're going through with. Jesus doesn't shy away from your anger. He doesn't shy away from your disappointment. He doesn't shy away from the hurt that you may have deep in your heart. He doesn't shy away from any of that. And he doesn't say, well, if you're in church long enough, maybe I'll fix it. He comes to you right in this moment. He says, if you'll follow me, everything will change. And here's Matthew, one-time tax collector, now turned disciple. And what I love about the transformation that took place in his life is this incredible humility now. Because as a tax collector, he would have been self-righteous. He would have been arrogant. He would have had to have put up that kind of a front in order to try to just help alleviate some of the pain and to try to alleviate some of the things that were always being said about him. He would have had to have been self-righteous. But now, because of what Jesus did in his life, he moves from that place of being self-righteous to a place of knowing that he is a sinner in need of God. And so the rest of his story, when you look throughout the rest of the Gospel of Matthew, he's only mentioned right here in Matthew chapter 9 where he talks about himself and the calling of Matthew, and then in the following chapter where he lists out the 12 disciples. What's so incredible, when he lists out the 12 disciples, he starts listing them out. Here's Peter and James and John and Judas, and he's naming all of them and gives a couple of names of their fathers, but then he lists himself. And he's the only one that he lists his occupation, and his former occupation, he says, in Matthew, the tax collector. Because he always wanted to make sure that he remembered what Jesus had saved him from, what Jesus had done in his life. And so the rest of the story, the rest of the good news, the rest of the Gospel of Matthew, as you go through it and you read it, you're going to find this one predominant theme. You're going to find Matthew always standing in the background with Jesus on center stage. Jesus is always the center of every story. Here's another little interesting fact, and I'm getting ready close. This is really interesting. Matthew, as a tax collector, like I said, would never have been allowed to go to, quote-unquote, the church, to be allowed to be around the religious crowd. He wouldn't have heard the sermons preached or taught or anything like that. Interesting fact, Matthew uses more Old Testament references in his gospel, in his story, than the other gospel writers. Now, how is that? If he rejected it, why would he then be turning around using more references to the Old Testament? If he wouldn't have been around the church and all that, why would he be using that? Here's what I really believe. I believe that Matthew wasn't anti-God. He was anti-religion. And that he would go home at night, probably sit by a little candle. And even though he couldn't go to the temple, there was something inside of him that was stirring. There was a void on the inside that extorting other people, collecting money, buying a bigger and better house, taking away from others, trying to live in the lap of luxury. There was something on the inside of him that none of that stuff could satisfy. That there was a gnawing hunger on the inside of Matthew. And he would go home at night and he would study and read those scriptures looking for a God who could set him free. And that's why when Jesus came along, there was a spiritual hunger in his life that immediately responded to the call of the Messiah. I want to show you a quick clip. It's from the recent series on the History Channel called the Bible Series, mini-series. I want to take you to just a quick snapshot of really this story that I've been talking about that I think will really help crystallize in your mind that moment. Watch this.